from China. From this new rising superpower, we mainly receive echoes, images of great cities, of swift development, of overpopulation, of rising pollution levels, and of all the negative side effects of a modern society. We rarely get to see the wild side of China, its mountains, its forests, and its unique fauna. The side of China that for millennia has inspired the philosophy and poetry of this enormous country. I've come to get the permits that will allow me to see the most prized treasures of its wildlife, some of which are considered icons of the world conservation movement. In a country that is so centralized, an okay from the State Forest Administration is absolutely necessary in order to visit places that are completely closed off to visitors. I have a meeting with Mr. Jin, director of the department that watches over China's nature reserves.
是挺是这样的，我正好在策划一个关于中国野生动物和自然保护区的纪录片，是吧？你们能不能给我一些建议啊，李处长？非常欢迎你到中国来。中国是野生动物植物非常丰富的国家，有很多特殊的珍稀的物种，有很多美丽的景观。为了保护这些自然资源呢，中国建立了很多自然保护区，现在有2400多处。
这次来呢，我想可能如果能有幸运的话，能看到一些珍贵的物种，比如这次我们如果再次在卧龙，这里能看到大熊猫。你到四川的唐家河保护区能看到羚牛，在四川的那个白河保护区呢能看到金丝猴。那你就能看到大熊猫。China
isn't a country, it is an entire world. Any attempt to understand it entails a long journey, which in my case begins in the mountainous east, in Sichuan.
Hey,
我名字叫莱奇，我是从北京过来的，我去过国家林业局，我想拍一个纪录片关于金丝猴的，你能帮我忙吗？
行，能。我这接到通知，正在等你们。现在我把这个地图叫你看一下。现在你们在太平山左，
太平村，沿这个道路。
从走到下平地，下平地有一个老职工唐代贵在里面，叫唐代贵给你们带路去，能看到猴子。我给你写个条子，请你带上。行，谢谢你啊，谢谢。
去下平地朝这个方向。今天太晚了。 明天你们再去，今天你们知道唐玉林家里，唐玉林家里从这面，从这下向左拐，再向左拐就到家了。那好，我先走了。那好，再见，谢谢。
Every long journey begins with a first step, as Mao himself was known to say. My first step here is called Tang.
你好，你好，你好，是的，你是，
你好，我是莱奇。
欢迎欢迎，请坐。谢谢啊。那听说你是在对这个保护这样，你是管理人吧？
是的，是的。
对金丝猴你比较了解。怎么说呢？可能观察的比别人多一些嘛。是吧？我们是过来拍一个纪录片。
谢谢。
我们是过来想拍一个纪录片关于金丝猴的，就说你能帮忙吗？
可以可以。
就说那哪一个日节是比较适合看到金丝猴的？
在我们这儿差不多什么时候都能看见，但是如果要拍的比较好，可能就5月跟10月比较好。上山的还是？除了看猴子，还有熊山的。
哦。
要看一看森林有没有虫啊，野生动物是有没有生病的。 植物国家保护，植物一级保护的有2种，国家二级保护的有30多种。
特别是非常有名的中国都非常有名的有红豆沙。
As I enter these tall forests on the mountaintops, at an altitude of over 3,000 meters, I have the feeling that I'm penetrating through closed-off territory. A territory that jealously hides a secret kept with the same zeal this country has kept its borders for centuries. Here, in the most extreme corner of China, in the highlands of the Himalayas, live the remains of the planet's last great wildlife group, still waiting to be discovered. The high dome of the forest is open under the rumble of the cicadas to show me the way to that new world.
唐先生，唐先生，哎，你好，您是唐先生吗？
我是。
我名字叫莱奇，这个是金先生让我给你的纪录片。
好的。
我们在这里是录个纪录片，想去看金丝猴，你能帮我去看吗？
我能带你去看。
好。
我们要一路去吗？
一起去。
我们一路去吗？
走。
At this wee hour of the morning, the first rays of sun set off life in the forest. Water flows up roots, sap flows through branches, the soil breathes. It is what we Chinese call being one with the earth and the sky, being in harmony, the same harmony that emanates from Mr. Tang.
我们白河保护区是63年建的。六三年建立保护区，这个那时候我们舅舅他是我们村上的从小长大的这个主人，他们对这个山上啊，对这个各种动物啊，他的这个经验很丰富。他对这个金丝猴的话，这个一天能够吃什么食物啊，能够走多远的路啊，他是很熟悉的。他对这个金丝猴的习性是很好的。在那时候是我们舅舅在管。舅舅管过了，最后就他老了，他们现在是没有这个，能力这个搞这个管理工作。舅舅过了，就是我在保护站，我在保护站以后呢，就是我们玉林，我们儿子在保护站管那个保护站的这个保护工作。我们儿子过了，就是我们孙子，我们孙子在这个叫叫我们的班长。玉林过后呢，就是我们孙子来搞这个管理这个保护站。但是我们在这个地方的话，对这个猴子这个吃什么东西，这个吃些什么这个，很熟悉的，吃那个三角蕨啊。
Up here, so far away from everything else, I like to think of the history of the Tang family, a history that runs parallel to the destiny of these forests. There have been four successive generations of forest keepers.Who have had a permanent and immutable relationship with these mountains. Nothing about them seems to change, just as nothing in nature changes beyond the rhythm of the seasons.
We go to the mountains to look for the food of the monkeys. The food of the monkeys is not very high, it's very high in the mountains. We go to the mountains to look at them. They are eating some things now, or they are eating some things yesterday. We go to the mountains.
Finding a group of monkeys in this vastness is a real challenge. However, high-pitched squeals alert us of their presence.
来吃，你看那些树上，那些树上啊，那些树上，那些树上。
Tang's help begins to show fruit. I witness what very few have seen. Others have spent weeks in these forests and have never found them.
排烟的话，那个牛角岭在一起的话，这个，这个玩耍，他们一个都不怕一块，牛角岭也不怕这个排烟，排烟也不怕这个牛角岭。
It's astounding that such noisy animals were never really known to Western science until early last century, when a British naturalist acquired some strips of torn skin in the remote province of Guizhou. It was the skin of a monkey that had never been seen before.He decided to name it, for obvious reasons, Golden Monkey from Guizhou. For the next 50 years, scientists searched for this animal to no avail, as they weren't able to find a living specimen. They even believed that they were dealing with an extinct species. During the 1960s, the Golden Monkeys finally entered the realm of science, though they did so through the back door. The first specimens found were captured and locked in the Beijing Zoo. The golden monkeys are related to langurs and other forest primates of Southeast Asia. Though their numbers have never been very abundant, there are only a few thousand left, according to the latest, albeit imprecise, census. And they are spread throughout the most remote mountain forests. There is a problem with this apparently large number, that of population fragmentation throughout the different mountain systems in these Himalayan highlands. This fragmentation, which eventually evolved into at least three different geographic breeds, has increased in recent decades due to human pressure. Troops of monkeys have been forced to seek refuge in the most remote areas, the most inaccessible valleys, all of which favors isolationism and endangers the viability of the species. They are the pioneers of these mixed forests, formed by varying species of pine and deciduous trees, which guarantees them a constant food source throughout the seasons. They live in large troops that move about on the upper strata of the forests at altitudes of about 1,000 to 2,500 meters. It is true that they do little more than eat, especially now that there is an abundance of tender pine shoots. Gone are the harsh, cold days of winter when lichens adhere to the oldest trunks and needles of little nutritional value from fir trees were their only food source. But Tang's look is very different from the impassionate focus of the scientist. Listening to him, it seems as though he speaks of the golden monkeys from a more personal point of view, almost with fondness and admiration.
搞了个宽剪的时候，一个看到一个这个很不好，把一个小的个小猴，就这么长的一个小猴，这个那个小猴是这个蛇，那个不好的话，把那个小猴一直在树上这个从盆子里往里面走，这样子一直在树上走，这个时候就一下就出东西，这个树上这个跑来跑去跑来往里滑，全部用在一个手，他一个手就把那个小猴子就抓起，抓了个两天到三天，三天以后就不见了，我们就看不到。那天晚上我们这个看的话，看到这个猜那个三米就谢了。 去了，我们看到他这个五六个、七八个、十几个，一堆一堆，全部在这个，在那个山顶上，全部给他抱起，一个抱一个，一个抱一个抱的出来，反正就这抱了这个有七八堆、十几堆，有些我们看不到，但是看到十几堆，关键是五六个、七八个、十个、一个一个，全部给他抱起。
This information obtained from their natural habitat is of great value. With some notable exceptions, almost everything we know about this species comes from studies carried out in captivity.
，1996年美国人到我们这来搞这个扩建的时候，我们带这个美国人上山这个拍那个镜头，我们搞扩建的时候看那个，有九零拦这个盘样在一起，这个盘样的话那个有九零在一起的话，这个玩耍他们一个都不怕一块，有九零也不怕这个盘样，盘样也不怕这个有九零，这是一个。
This fortunate scientist was Dr. Craig Kirkpatrick. After hundreds of hours of in situ observations that were almost always incomplete and carried out under harsh conditions, he was able to establish basic behavioral patterns and the social structure of these bands. A rather difficult task if we consider that these animals tend to hide among the trees, that they are capable of appearing and disappearing without notice, and that they are constantly on the move with amazing agility along the steepest mountainsides imaginable. After working for so many years in the field, all this yelling must have been fixed in their memory. As with all social species, and especially among primates, the voice is one of the basic means of communication. Hordes of golden monkeys move surrounded by yelling, high-pitched squealing, cries, an occasional burp, and deep sighs. And from all these noises, one can discern what they mean. The rough yelling, loud and dry like a whiplash, means that they are out of danger. It is a sign that things are normal, and it can be emitted by any member of the group. The ominous silence following said yell is in fact what gives it its meaning. Other calls mean warning, signals that all is quiet, contact calls between recently arrived specimens, warnings to potential competitors, just part of a repertoire of at least 18 different calls. All this talk undoubtedly reflects a very high degree of social intelligence. But science is not the only valid means of understanding how things work in these Baihe mountains. Tang has his own surprising ideas to explain the survival of these monkeys in this idyllic landscape. And if there are new humans, monkeys can live in peace and deal with their own issues. This behavior is not the only manifestation of their adaptation to cold mountain climates. Some parts of their anatomy seem to have been designed to conserve body heat, starting with their golden thick coat. Though in the case of the great males, their fur has a lot to do with flirting and seduction. But its robust body and limbs are also common characteristics of animals exposed to extreme climates. Golden monkeys adhere to the rule that a large body is better suited to conserve heat at low temperatures. Now then, whether they are solidarious or not, peace and harmony within the group depend on obedience to the established hierarchy. In this conservative society, threats are preferable over actual fighting. Signs of menace, such as this apparent yawn, are used only to serve notice of the potential devastating effect of an attack with such terrifying defenses. Such multitudes require the establishment of complex social ties, elaborate networks that relate individuals to each other with varying degrees of dependency. Thus, the basic structure of the community revolves around two types of groupings. One that is formed by small harems made up of a dominant male, four or five females, and the immature individuals and surviving young of the latest births. And alongside this grouping, there is another, a small bands of solitary males who are not allowed to reproduce. Many of these groups maintain a hierarchical relationship, and a certain number of these larger cells form a type of confederacy under the leadership of a true council of elders, adult males that are more experienced and, who knows, maybe even wiser. It is wonderful to discover the usefulness of so much hierarchy. And although there aren't too many natural enemies, these groupings of golden monkeys have developed a sophisticated first alert system in order to guarantee the safety of the young as they move about, as well as during the long periods of time in which they eat. As they advance or as they eat, the monkeys arrange themselves in a certain way, with lines of males spread throughout the group, forming a defensive perimeter and alert to any danger as the females with their young move in the interior of the circle.
China not only is a large population, it is also in an economic development stage. Its resource protection and 人类的生产生活这方面呢，面对很大的压力。应该讲，中国从56年开始就重视自然保护工作。当时在国家林业局、在国务院的指导下，规划组织编制了一个自然保护发展规划，从此开始了中国的自然保护建设工作。在这50年当中呢，已经建立了2400处自然保护。
The conservation and secular isolation of these natural areas has maintained the most archaic forms of rural Chinese culture. These quiet mountains are the setting of undying beliefs of a diffuse religion, halfway between philosophy and respect for ancestors, which defines what in China is known as ancient religion. Mrs. Tang, wife of the eldest survivor of a long line of Baihe forest rangers, the revered king of the monkeys, continues the tradition of offerings to their ancestors. In a country in which the elderly are still equated with wisdom, Tang Kuo Shun is an institution. As I visit him in the company of his nephew and grandson, I am afforded a different perspective on many things. In this country, formalisms are usually the road to knowledge, and the ancient king of the monkeys is undoubtedly an endless source of information. He must be around 100 years old, although not even he knows his exact age.
Yeah. 有经验很多，懂得这个很多，你可以对他讲一讲这个金丝猴的故事。
听不懂吗？那是你的大点的。
哦，那就说我们就是想再拍个纪录片，想知道就说你们那时候怎么会成那个？
现在金丝猴，我们知道在金丝猴同人心，胸脸的造同人心，完全没问题。一起跟一天两天，他不会干饭，他不惊慌，别处一家人就非得看不到，我们这次看得到，松来就让他那个大脸部软松了，不害怕。这个金丝猴，中国这个的金丝猴看得到了，别处都看不到，我是晓得。从此以来，我们去了金丝猴大教堂拍一顿。
从小就是内部的宝啊！
哦，都是在这里长大的。哦，我们都是这里村子长大的，是吧？哦，那好，那你现在已经退休了是吧？
看着这个金丝猴，这个要吃些什么东西，或者冬天要走好高，或者是这个夏天要走好高，它要吃什么东西，它对这个食物的这个情况它很了解的。它对这个猴子的这个习性，这个猴子的几月份下这个小的崽崽，几月份的怀这个小崽崽，它的都很有经验的。 他对这个山上的话，这个到处就是这个熊山啊，这个门前的熊山啊，他是不怕苦不怕累的。
哎，谭先生，哎，你跟我解释一下，就说金丝猴他们哪一段时节是最好最适合的去看看金丝猴？
金丝猴是最适合的，是二月啊和三月啊是最适合的。它那个时候这个树的这个芽呀，根上的树芽发育早，它下来吃这个树的嫩芽，进的时候它对这个。
The search for an animal species has led me to something I wasn't searching for.The Tangs, a long line of rangers, and Baihe, secular isolationism, are the face side of the coin. The tail side is modernization, openness to the rest of the world, development. China is today a lab for environmental management, but I suspect that as long as people like this live around here, the golden monkeys and everything they represent will survive.
九寨沟呢是一个国家级的自然保护区，我们这个景区的面积也比较大，在这儿呢动物人与自然是和谐相处，像我们动物呢随处可见，但是你要看到大的动物的话就要走到这林子里面，而且要走到大山里面去，因为大的动物都靠累。
哦，那我是过来拍一个纪录片，我想找到羚牛，你能说就说羚牛这里哪地方？
在这里呢可以看到羚牛，但是你得走了一个很高很远的路，还会走一些上山的路，走很远去才能看到羚牛这样大的动物。
Although it might seem like a contradiction, the arrival of mass tourism makes the real mountains seem even further away and higher up.And up in these heights,Up in this steep crest, shaped by cutting winds and almost always veiled in fog, I have come in search of herds of takins, the most symbolic animal of the highest pastures of the Himalayas. It will be a long trip, since these animals undergo altitudinal migrations to the rhythm of the seasons, from the alpine pastures in the spring to the depths of valleys when the cold and harshness of autumn force them downhill.Luck continues to follow me on this search for the emblems of the great Chinese fauna. It's not easy to find a herd this large, except maybe here in the Mingshan Mountains in the Tanjia He Reserve. Now, in August, is when the females are in heat, the only time in which males mate with females to form large herds. Up here, the pleasant season is very short, and time is of essence. Copulation is continuous as ephemeral as it is effective.If there is any sign of danger, the herd will respond by seeking protection, alerted by a kind of rough cough. The agility these animals display is surprising.They are capable of moving along the rocks with a kind of heavy ease. After about 7 or 8 months of gestation, in the early spring, every female will give birth to one offspring. Only rarely are two offspring born at once, a rare exception which these images seem to suggest.Summer is almost over, and these pastures offer little refuge. The fog permanently covers the peaks, and it seems that the air is heavy with the aroma of the new season. It's time to look for cover and sustenance in the forests. Unlike the golden monkeys, populations of takins can be found throughout an ample area, from Tibet to Bhutan, from Burma to southern China.But unfortunately, as is the case with primates, fragmentation of the territory, human pressure and hunting have all played a role in cornering takin herds into the most inaccessible areas, far from what their optimum ecological choice would be. Upon closely contemplating this male's soft wool, I feel I'm the protagonist of the Tibetan legend, the story of a nomadic shepherd.Who sets off with a group of adventurers in search of the prodigious wool from a unique mythical animal living in these heights. It was because of this legend that I learned of the Takin, and also that Tibetans have their Jason, their Argonauts, and their Golden Fleece. The audible landscape becomes poorer in autumn. One can barely make out the pecking of woodpeckers on the oldest of tree trunks. But what is lost in music is gained in color. A view of the colors of autumn is a view into the enormous variety of these forests. Unlike those in Europe, most of the forests of the warm Asian mountains are formed by a large variety of species. Here, it's not just about fir, beech, and oak forests. Every red hue, every shade of green and yellow belongs to a group of larch, birch, sorbus, beech, maple, fir, pine, or bamboo. I can't think of a name for a forest like this. Counting colors is tantamount to quantifying biodiversity. The problems associated with the reproductive seasons are far behind us. Males no longer feel the need to compete with others. For a few months, they become solitary animals that graze in the deepest parts of the forest and try to stay out of sight, a useful lesson learned from their ancient fight with bears, wolves, and rifles. The creamy and dirty color of their fleece helps them blend in with the brownish colors of autumn. It's quite difficult to describe the Takin in just a few words. It looks like an antelope, but it's heavy set like an ox, although undoubtedly its horns are almost exactly like a buffalo's or like a wild beast's. And it is similar to a sheep, but alas, the Takin is not a zoological riddle. It's really a creature perfectly adapted to the harsh conditions that characterize the climate of its habitat. If one had to design a herbivore capable of living in these frozen mountains at altitudes of up to 4,500 meters and permanently in contact with frost, the result would be a Takin. We saw before that the golden monkey's corpulence was an adaptation to cold weather. The body mass of a Takin, with a weight of up to 400 kilograms among the more robust males, generates so much heat that the surface of its stumped body, proportionately smaller in relation to its body mass, cannot dissipate it efficiently. A good-sized body is always a good coat. Its legs, short like an ox's, are robust enough to hold up such a heavy body and keep it in balance on this highly uneven terrain. Its puffed-up profile is due to its ample nasal cavities, which are necessary to warm up the air before it goes into the respiratory ducts. Faced with such a riddle, scientists, who are practical people, created a category exclusive to the Takins and called them budorkas, which freely translated means goat antelope. The mythical origin of the species is more lyrical, as it is related to the religious tradition of Bhutan, where the Takin is a national symbol. According to legend, in the 15th century, a swarm of devotees surrounded the venerable Lama Drukpa Khunlei to see him perform a miracle. In highly unorthodox fashion, this saintly character first asked to be fed a cow and a goat, no less, which he devoured before the astonished faithful. When he finished his meal, leaving only the uneaten bones, the Lama placed the head of the cow atop the skeleton of the goat and ordered this strange creation to go out and graze on the mountainside. And what seemed highly improbable, both back then and today, occurred. The bones got up, they became covered with a thick coat of wool, and began to eat its way up the mountain. Among the many questions this story raises, the existence of Takins in the Himalayas before the saint's feast is not the least important. What Takins don't need now are miracles. Rather, they need respect and proper safeguarding habits to guarantee its survival.
在这50年当中呢，我们的保护区取得了很大成效，为中国的野生动植物保护做出了很大的贡献。据我们最近的调查统计呢，这些自然保护区已经保护了我们75%的生态系统类型。这些保护成果是非常来之不易的。大家知道，我们可能从这个2003年的大熊猫的调查当中就已经有所体现。当时的大熊猫种群从上世纪90年代的1100只到今年第2003年的调查当中呢，已经达到1590只，保护成效是非常显著。
A large part of those pandas live here in the inaccessible mountainsides of Oolong. I've come here to meet one of the persons who knows them the best, Director Zeng.
哎，郑局长，你好。
啊，来西来西。
哎，你好，你好，你好，你好，很久没见了，这是第二次见面了。啊。从那时候北京，我们两个人第一次见面的时候，那时候已经过了好多时间了，我去过好多地方了。
自然保护区确实不错，其他地方是不容易看到的啊。你看我们景色也挺不错啊，有这个。山水有自然风光，更重要的还有像这个珍稀动物，像那些这种木屋，在这个各个保护区都有这种木屋，主要是用于野生动物野外监测用的。在中国的卧龙自然保护区，他们人工繁殖的大熊猫要进行野外。这种野外犯规训练的时候，这种木屋主要是用于他们这个大熊猫的监测工作。我们现在还是一块去找熊猫吧。
Director Zeng's good intentions summarize the radical change in the authorities and in Chinese society with respect to giant pandas. These bears.Which are closely linked to bamboo forests, lost more than 50% of their territory in less than 30 years during the second half of the 20th century. Grazing and intensive exploitation of the forests forced these animals into a critical situation as they were incapable of adapting to sudden changes. But as often occurs in the best of stories, the pandas came out in extremis from the depths of the forest.Captured worldwide attention and became a true icon for the endangered natural world. Nowadays, the giant panda has become part of the emblematic fauna of Chinese society, and much effort is made to ensure its survival. And here they are, black and white.Upon a background of green, one of the best logos for the conservation of nature and the awakening of environmental awareness. Although seeing them like this, they don't really appear to be too concerned about their immediate future. Pandas are true gluttons, but they don't really have a choice. Their diet is 99% based on bamboo shoots and leaves, an abundant source of food available all year round.But very poor in nutritional value. Because of this, they spend 10 to 12 hours a day eating, compensating through quantity what they lack in quality. The remaining 1% of their intake consists of fruits, berries, insects, and exceptionally, small mammals and fish. Though they are basically land-based animals, they are often found atop trees,where they show off their climbing skills. or lack of them. But we shouldn't be fooled. If the golden monkeys were specially made to move amongst the tree branches, and the heavy takins are the best solution to the mountain frost, the giant pandas seem to be specifically designed to elicit tenderness. This specimen is undoubtedly a fierce and very aggressive individual from whom it is better to keep a safe distance. But its stumpy body, its fat and short limbs, its enormous head, protruding ears, and above all, these ocular spots that make their eyes seem bigger than they are, lend these animals a rather infantile appearance, as if they were cute puppies destined to never mature. The giant panda is the Peter Pan of environmental awareness. But in nature, everything has a reason. Its black and white hair, for instance, may have served as a costume against its former predators when pandas were prey to numerous natural enemies. Within the thick of the forest, the interface between white and black serves to fade out its silhouette, to blend into its own chiaroscuro. It is a similar effect, for example, to that of zebras with their striped skin in the African savanna. A mimetic effect with snow might have also been a factor in the appearance of white hair, especially in the past, when it seems that their habitat was at much higher altitudes. In any event, its present-day enemies, mainly wolves and clouded leopards, are so rare that they don't really pose a major threat to pandas. It is very rare that giant pandas leave their solitary life to fraternize with other members of its own species. Here in the Oolong Reserve, there is a high density of pandas due mainly to a high birth rate in the Center for the Control of Births, which allows for a greater degree of sociability. I had heard about it, but I had never seen it in action. The panda's thumb, an adaptation from a primordial claw common to bears, is non-prehensile, but with it, it is able to firmly grasp bamboo shoots. Pandas have developed a false sixth finger, an elongation of a wrist bone that acts as an opposable thumb. They thus imitate the functionality of our hands, capable of grabbing, holding, and stretching. Any form of dependence has its risks and its advantages. Bamboo is a readily available food source, but it's prone to serious cyclic fluctuations. Periodically, masses of bamboo collapse and degrade until they disappear. Pandas, incapable of eating anything else, have always been forced to migrate in search of new territories. There was a time when this wasn't a problem, until the fragmentation of their habitat raised unsurmountable obstacles for these bamboo eaters. For some time now, thanks to an efficient territorial administration policy, wild populations have found at last a certain degree of stability, even if they are small and are dangerously far away from each other. The exchange with individuals raised in captivity is a key tool to avoid the genetic impoverishment within these isolated groups. Fortunately, some ancient dangers are disappearing, bounty hunting, for example. Until not too long ago, fortunes could be made on a panda skin that, when converted into a bed cover, had the supposed ability to make whoever slept under it dream into the future. But there are those of us who dream of seeing nature free from such stupid superstitions. Nowadays, The panda is the emblematic animal of the People's Republic of China. Although it feeds all types of commercial interests, from cookies, vehicles, cartoon series, and even certain antiviral systems. Even in love, excesses have a downside. Pandamania also started out as a menace. For some time, there wasn't a zoo in the world that did not want to exhibit a giant panda of its own. In the phases previous to its commercial openness, Chinese authorities gave pandas away left and right. One could even make a case for panda diplomacy, in which a trail of cage animals were left after visits to foreign nations by important Chinese dignitaries. Golden monkeys, takins, and giant pandas, the three jewels of the wild, the remote survivors of the most populated corner of the world, three icons of hope. Each of them has their place in an intact natural world. Each one of them maintains the values of the wild. Their presence then says a lot. It manifests the good health of the natural areas they inhabit. The existence of these natural paradises is the grand surprise that China's openness reveals. These remote places have been conserved because of their inaccessibility and because of those long years in which the Chinese economy languished while the West experienced its own economic takeoff. We hope that the development brought about by China's openness will allow these paradises to last, and that contrary to the West, where we have almost done away with wildlife, China knows how to conserve theirs.